Jefferson of the Two Johns and a Joe. We're minus the Joe today, but this is kind of a crazy day. We're expecting a big storm on its way from the hurricane down in Florida.
It's Hurricane Depeche Mode today.
Hurricane Depeche Mode. And we're going to bring you some of the mainstream hits, basically, of Depeche Mode. Okay. Yeah. I don't really know too much of the band. Other than their English band, and yeah. They started around 1979, around that time.
One of the ironies is they're from Basildon, which is about 25 miles or so, or maybe 20 miles or so away from Chelmsford, which is where my grandmother was from.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. England is so small, everybody knows everybody. Nobody in the Jefferson family knows Depeche Mode.
That was nobody knows.
No, I think I'm the only person who knows, who can identify the sound and put the name of the band. When I was younger, ironically, and Depeche Mode would have videos on MTV, and my grandmother and I were flipping through the stations, we'd stop whenever they were playing Personal Jesus or Enjoy the Silence or Policy of Truth, and we'd stop and listen, and she liked the band. She was...
Was this in England? Were you watching it in England? Or
no, in North Bergen.
North Bergen. Now, it doesn't have quite the same cadre, you know. It doesn't have the same, what do you call it, snob appeal or
We do live high on a mountain in North Bergen.
Though. Well, okay, yeah. We are high in the mountain.
We're missing the castle. We're missing the moat. Although I have it on good authority. There's a coming in the mail next month.
Okay. But so Depeche Mode origins, as I said, date back to 1977, when schoolmates Vince Clark, Andy Fletcher formed the Cure-influenced band called No Romance in China. Yeah. Not a catchy name, no.
No, that's why it never got off the ground.
Okay, with Clark on vocals and Fletcher and guitar, and Fletcher on the bass. They started basically small. They got Martin Gore, played guitar, Norman and the Worms. That was where he came from. Another not a very catchy name, Norman and the Worms. I don't think I'd go see that group.
No, not even Depeche Mode is a catchy name.
Yeah.
They don't get high marks for their creativity and ingenuity in band names.
Right. So they kind of switched, though, to synthesizers,
yes.
Okay, and they switched to a variety of sounds, and they got a sound. They definitely got a unique sound.
Yes,
it was kind of style. They had a style to them, and they had that 80s style.
They had the new wave look that the Cure didn't have. The Cure had the punk rock look with Robert Smith had his hair teased.
Yeah.
Paul Thompson and Simon Gallup had their hair and their certain. I'm trying to think. I don't know if they were mods or what they didn't really dress the same way that the new wave people did, even though they were in the new wave, not in the genre, but in the same period of time as the new wave people were. Where Depeche Mode is all new wave.
Yeah.
They don't have anything heavy.
Yeah.
Their songs are depressing, the same as the Cure stuff is, but they're. They're not so much the fashion that Cure had. Mm-hmm. Cure had more of a punk fashion.
Mm-hmm.
Now, maybe that's a British thing. But they do have a unique sense of sound. Whenever you hear the real hit songs, Enjoy the Silence or Policy of Truth, Enjoy the Silence has been covered by a bunch of different people. And even heavy metal bands like Lacuna Coil, which is you know, kind of a gothic band from Italy covered Enjoy the Silence. Mm-hmm. A Swedish death metal band called In Flames covered Everything Counts. Mm-hmm. So Depeche Mode has, you know, had a wide reach.
Yeah.
Touched a lot of people.
And it, I liked a lot of their songs. I must admit it had a very catchy sound, a kind of, not right in your face kind of sound, a kind of ethereal sound.
It's easy to listen to, and it has, ethereal is perfect for it.
Yeah.
Because it really is ethereal.
Okay, we're going to play another song, and this is called Words in My Eyes. And what album does this come from?
This is from Violator. This
Violator,
is the opening track.
That was their most popular.
Let me take you.
I like that song.
I do.
I do too.
You mentioned the ethereal quality. Yeah. It has smooth transitions from notes that are not in the same minor key. It just, there's the drone of the keyboard.
Yeah.
No, it's nice.
It really is. And it almost puts you in a kind of hypnotic trance kind of thing where you just like, it's kind of repetitive. It's kind of a repetitive sound.
I could imagine, I do this whenever I listen to Depeche Mode or electronic bands, just lay on the couch and, almost like it puts you to sleep.
Yeah.
If it was slower paced, it would put you to sleep, but it's got that energetic beat in the background.
It's got a beat. So
it's got a pulse.
It's got a pulse to it. Yeah. So it says here, People to People kind of was their first hit in Australia and the UK. And put them on the map, and then a few other, this song came about, and then they started getting airplay in the States, and they started building.
They were lumped in the same group as like Duran Duran.
Right.
Everybody that was electronica was all rowing in the same boat.
Right.
And they're a little bit different. You know, Duran Duran is more pop than these guys.
Yeah.
These guys have a little bit harder of an edge.
Right.
You know, Duran Duran has, Hungry Like the Wolf and Rio and stuff like that.
Yeah, it's more of a
syrupy.
It's more poppy.
More syrupy pop.
Yeah, more syrupy and more commercial sounding. Where this is a kind of a subliminal. It kind of gets you in. Yeah. It's an in-between thing that your conscious and your unconscious are connected in some way.
Yeah. It's a little bit eclectic.
So then they had some great reward in 1984. Is that an album of theirs? Construction Time Again?
They had a couple of albums between the first and Violator that didn't chart well, didn't go over.
Right.
They were just...
Black Celebration, Music for the Masses.
Music for the Masses was a good album, but didn't have any hit singles.
Right. But Violator comes.
Almost everything on Violator screams up the charts.
1989 and to 1991. Worldwide fame it brought them. They recorded most of this in Milan. And just about every song on here becomes a hit.
Yeah. Especially the ones that were made into music videos.
Right.
Personal Jesus, Policy of Truth. They become massive hits. I remember watching the videos as I must have been 10 or 11 years old. Mm-hmm. I remember watching the videos, and they weren't like the typical rock star videos. Like AC/DC had concert videos of the four guys playing their instruments. These guys didn't have that. Mm-hmm. Their videos were not experimentations. It wasn't like Peter Gabriel's Shock the Monkey or Sledgehammer.
Right.
It was just like... The video didn't matter, the music mattered.
Right.
And that was different for the prime time age of MTV when everything was video, 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 and the songs could be horrible.
So we have some songs here, Walking in My Shoes, World in My Eyes, Policy of Truth. Which one are they from the Violator album that we can play?
Policy of Truth.
I think
we have the studio version from the album. And we have a live version from a concert in Los Angeles.
Okay.
So you can have your choice.
All right, so here is Policy of Truth.
When we come back, we'll tell you what it's about.
Right.
There's a good story behind it.
What you feel?
Okay, that was Depeche Mode and
Policy of Truth.
Policy of Truth. I like it off the Violator album, which became their escort into world fame.
Violator for Depeche Mode is like album 4 for Led Zeppelin. It made everybody a fan. Everybody likes it.
Everybody liked it.
Ironically, that song "Policy of Truth" is an anti-Margaret Thatcher song.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the guys in Depeche Mode are from England,
right?
And they're not stupid. They studied, you know, they studied current events and they know what's going on in the world.
Right.
And during the '80s, Britain had an awkward period of contraction in its empire. There was the war in the Falklands. There's trouble here and there.
Well, the Falklands, I saw Iron Lady with Meryl Streep as Margaret Thatcher, the story of life.
Yeah.
She was fairly unpopular until that war. And then that war, yeah. Everybody became patriotic, and she became like an iconic figure after that.
Yeah.
But I could see where her policy, would rankle anybody from, you know, mainstream to liberal. She's conservative
conservative in England is different from conservative in America. When you think of conservatives in America, you think maybe of a Rush Limbaugh or a Sean Hannity commentator kind of person.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
We don't really have real conservative political leaders in this country.
Mm-hmm.
The Republicans are slightly to the right of the Democrats.
Mm-hmm.
You know, maybe a guy like Rand Paul, you could argue, is a conservative. In England, it's much watered down.
Yeah.
You know, Margaret Truth still believes in the social welfare programs and still doesn't want to get rid of the infrastructure of England. In America, a conservative like Rand Paul would say, pension for old age? The government gives you money, you don't pay into it? No way, we'd never do that. But in England, it's, you know, hey, we take care of old people.
Mm-hmm.
England is very small. America is a massive idea, but England is very small, and they believe, well, if you're English, then we'll take care of you.
Yeah.
You buy into the idea of being British.
Mm-hmm.
So there's the socialized healthcare system, there's the socialized rail system. You get things that would never work in America, like the congestion pricing. Nobody's really protesting that. People just, okay, so I won't go to London. But here in America, you'd have people burning those toll roads
down.
What
did you say that was?
Congestion pricing.
What exactly is that again?
In order to drive into London, you have to actually pay. It's like putting tolls on the ordinary streets.
Right.
If you wanted to drive your car, you actually have to pay. I think it's something like £10 a day extra on top of paying for parking, if you can find parking. London, you've been to London. London's like New York City.
Yeah.
Traffic sucks.
Yeah, really, it is very congested, and there's not much parking, you know, very little parking, and like New York City. I mean, London's probably as pricey, or if not pricier, than New York City.
Yeah.
I mean, food is sky high. Buy something going to a restaurant. It's not inexpensive at all, and. And that's the way, you know, I was down in Jamaica last month, and again, they have that similar setup where if you're Jamaican, we're going to take care of you some way or another.
That's from the British Commonwealth.
Right. Yeah. So, you know, even if you're not working or even if you're very poor, some basic services will be available for you, you know, and there's a real sense of community in these smaller countries. Well, the United States is so large and so...
Yeah.
So many nationalities.
At the federal level, those social programs don't really work.
Yeah.
It's not bad ideas. You never meet anybody, not even a conservative, would say, just let them starve. Let them die. We don't care about people. Conservatives care about people. But the federal programs are too big. They just don't work.
Yeah.
If you could make them small, if you could leave it up to the states, as the laboratories of democracy, you could give it to the states, you know, it would work.
Yeah,
people get behind it, and nobody would complain.
Yeah, but we're going to go on to Depeche Mode. We're talking about Depeche Mode, but it sounds like we're talking about, you know, the different countries.
Well, Depeche Mode isn't. Well, the lyrical themes deal with British politics.
Yeah,
and you have to have a context. It's not just. So much of what I learned about politics has come from being interested. By music, you know, the lyrics in Depeche Mode songs, lyrics in Megadeth songs.
These guys got pretty involved in drugs.
The lead singer himself had a couple of serious run-ins with heroin.
Yeah, it kind of looks like he went that way, and you can almost tell when you look at somebody. They're into it. You know, they got into it, and somehow they have the tattoos to prove it.
You know, there's sometimes my students and I will talk about just life, and I have like Mr. Jefferson's life lessons every so often. And every once in a while, the kids will ask, "So, Mr. Jefferson, what do you think about legalizing marijuana? What do you think about this drug, that drug? What do you think about so and so that got busted for drugs?" And I tell them, just from one human to another human, drugs didn't do anything good, and especially. Something like heroin.
Yeah.
And I try to avoid making a hierarchy with heroin is worse than marijuana, or heroin's worse than PCP, and cocaine is this much, and heroin is this much. But it's all bad.
Yeah, you know.
This did nothing good for
Dave Gahan. No, not really. Marijuana has some medicinal properties and medicinal uses, but I would never.
That comes from the plant. That doesn't come from THC, the active.
Right.
Ingredient that makes you hallucinate.
Never recommend that you'd ever get on that or use that. But we're kind of hypocritical in the fact that alcohol, which is probably just as lethal as these other drugs, are promoted as the social well-being
drug
to take. It's a drug. I hate to say it, but it impairs you when you drive. It impairs your decision making, and it can lead to all kinds of physical incapabilities, especially your liver. You know, ask Mickey Mantle. and some other
or even Jeff Hanneman, guitarist from Slayer, passed away a couple of weeks ago. Yeah. So alcohol-related cirrhosis.
Right. So
that happens all the time.
The way our society presents alcohol as like
glamorous.
But socially accepted way to get yourself high or get yourself out of it, and it's kind of you're a good guy if you just use alcohol, and you're the bad guy if you use pot, you know, or you use other drugs, which is completely hypocritical and double standard, I think. And if you're going to ban one substance, you should ban the other, but there's just too much money to be made, or as is being made in alcohol, you know. Yeah. So you'd cut down so many industries, so many jobs, so much profit that I don't ever see that happening.
Yeah. Depeche Mode wrote a song called Everything Counts, which deals with corporate greed.
Yeah.
In a vague, you know, a lyrical theme way, not a direct anti-corporate thing.
Yeah.
But it's how ironic that even Depeche Mode thinks about things like that too.
Yeah.
Now, it's not just a British pop band, they're not the Beatles, they're thinking a little bit better than the average bear.
Well, they're probably educated, more educated than the average band, like Genesis. I mean, Genesis, they came from pretty wealthy backgrounds and private schools, and it reflected in their writings.
They're certainly not high school dropouts.
Not high school dropouts, so...
No, they're not the Ramones.
Yeah, not the Ramones, or the Stones.
I mean,
Mick Jagger went to... Didn't he go to economic college?
At London School of Economics.
So he's not...
That's a very prestigious school, very expensive.
They don't come, of course, literate. The Stones don't go for the cerebral approach, let's put it that way. They go for the gut. They go for the lower emotions.
They're more into the soul aspect of music
rather
than the thinking aspect of music.
Yeah, they want you to feel the music first, and then, you know, whatever the lyrics are.
The vocals, and ironically, this is the same way that it works in like death metal and black metal bands. The vocals are just another instrument.
Yeah.
The words don't mean anything.
Right.
And in many cases, don't make any sense.
Right.
And it's just another sound to put on the palette of sounds.
Yeah. So, you know, the perfect music to me is when the lyrics and the melody and the music connect. And each one is important in their own way. You know, they supplement each other, and you really excellent music. So, we're gonna another song that you would recommend. We got Question of Time, Enjoy the Silence, Everything Counts, World in My Eyes.
Well, we heard The World in My Eyes. Everything Counts was from, I think it was 86 or 87, about the corporate greed. Enjoy the Silence is one that people would recognize.
All right, let's find Enjoy the Silence. Here it is right now.
And that's...
We're listening to Depeche Mode with the two John and Joe.
WHIT Radio.
Crashing into my little world, painful to me.
Okay, that's our show for today on Depeche Mode. I want to thank John Jefferson, of the two Johns and the Joe. I'm John Pacino, and you're listening to WHIT radio.org.